God belong mercies and forgivenesses. Though we have rebelled against him, neither have we obeyed the voice of the Lord our God to walk in his laws which he set before us. Hide thy face from my sins and blot out all mine iniquities. O Lord, correct me, but with judgment, not in thine anger, lest thou bring me to nothing. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Dearly beloved brethren, the scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickednesses, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with an humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary, as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore, I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace, saying with me, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done. And we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us miserable offenders. Spare thou them, God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto mankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life to the glory of thy holy name. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, and hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins, he pardoneth and absolveth all them that truly repent and unfeignedly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore, let us beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
As he is, God, as he will be, he is now.
Please be seated. A very warm welcome to St. Thomas Church, Fifth Avenue, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And to those of you who are joining us around the world via the live stream, welcome to this celebration of Choral Evensong. Immediately following Evensong, we have a beautiful recital of two Lenten Bach cantatas performed by Brian Mummert, Margaret Carpenter-Haig, and the St. Thomas Baroque Ensemble. You're welcome to stay on. It's a free concert. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday. When you leave the church, if you haven't picked one up, do take one of our beautiful postcards. It has all the details of our Holy Week services. And next Sunday evening, we welcome a dear friend of our parish, the Dean Emeritus of Canterbury, the very Reverend Robert Willis, who will begin a series of Lenten of Holy Week sermons for us. So that's beginning next Sunday at 4 p.m. with Dean Robert, and then he'll be preaching during Holy Week. Do take the card home with you. Well, this evening we bring to a conclusion our Lenten sermon series on the practice of prayer. And it's a delight to welcome back to the pulpit Canon Stuart Kenworthy, the interim vicar of Washington Cathedral, the National Cathedral. And Father Stuart was an associate here when Father John Andrew was rector. So it's good to have you back, and you can tell us lots of stories later. I'm sure there are many to tell. The choir will now sing Psalm 34.
Thank you. The Old Testament lesson is written in the first book of Exodus, chapter 15, beginning to read at verse 22. So Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea, and they went out into the wilderness of Shur, and they went 3 days in the wilderness and found no water. And when they came to Marah, they could not drink of the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. Therefore the name of it was called Marah, and the people murmured against Moses, saying, "What shall we drink?" And he cried unto the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree, which when he had cast into the waters were made sweet. There he made for them a statute and an ordinance, and there he proved them and said, "If thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and wilt do that which is right in his sight, and wilt give ear to his commandments and keep all his statutes, I will put none of these diseases upon thee, which I have brought upon the Egyptians, for I am the Lord that healeth thee." So ends the first lesson.
Thank you. The New Testament lesson is written in the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 6, beginning to read at verse 12. It came to pass in those days that Jesus went out into a mountain to pray and continued all night in prayer to God. And when it was day, he called unto his disciples, and one of them he chose, and of them he chose 12, whom also he named apostles: Simon, whom he also named Peter, and Andrew his brother, James and John, Philip and Bartholomew, Matthew and Thomas, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon called Zelotes, and Judas the brother of James, and Judas Iscariot, which also was the traitor. And he came down with them and stood in the plain and the company of his disciples. And a great multitude of people out of all Judea and Jerusalem and from the east coast of Tyre and Sidon, which came to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. And they that were vexed with unclean spirits, and they were healed. And the whole multitude sought to touch him, for there went virtue out of him and healed them all. So ends the second lesson.
Thank you. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of life, and the life everlasting. Amen.
O God, may clean our hearts within us. Jesus Christ, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Almighty and everlasting God, who hatest nothing that thou hast made, and dost forgive the sins of all them who are penitent, create and make in us new and contrite hearts, that we, worthily lamenting our sins and acknowledging our wretchedness, may obtain of thee, the God of all mercy, perfect remission and forgiveness, through Jesus Christ our Lord. O God, from whom all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works do proceed, give unto thy servants that peace which the world cannot give, that both our hearts may be set to obey thy commandments, and also that by thee we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness. Through the merits of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Light in our darkness, we beseech thee, O Lord, and by thy great mercy, defend us from all perils and dangers of this night. For the love of thy only Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ.
the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace and peace be with you. I stand before you this evening with a full and grateful heart for your invitation through your rector, Father Carl Turner, to return to St. Thomas Church and step into this pulpit once again. 43 years ago, after a season of inquiry and prayerful discernment, I departed ministry in the Methodist Church with good and wise counsel from several priests, one of whom was the late Frank Tracy Griswold, who became and is now the one-time presiding bishop of the Episcopal Church. Father Andrew Mead, Rector Emeritus, was on the Commission on Ministry in the Diocese of Pennsylvania, a necessary way in to the Episcopal Church. And I have actually known Andy Mead since I was 14 years old. I think I was chasing after his sister. So it was off to General Theological Seminary in Chelsea for 2 years of immersion in Anglican studies that was life-changing, as was becoming the seminarian while there at St. Thomas Church. After ordination to the priesthood, I returned to St. Thomas as one of four curates, and that too was life-changing, informative, right into this very day. It wasn't just the choral tradition or the rhythm and the pulse of the daily offices, three masses a day, which set the course for priesthood over long years. It was also the friendships in God and life with many who were part of this great parish church. Fathers John Gerald Barton Andrew, Gary Fertig, Robert Stafford, Dorsey McConnell, Leslie Lang, Gordon Hurst Barrow, J. Robert Wright, and others. It was Jerry and Judy Hancock, Gordon Clem, Claudette and Eddie Thomas, Francina and Jerry, and so many wonderful parishioners, including the recently deceased Sister Mary Owen, also known in those years as Ursula D. Simone, who I counseled into the religious life of St. Mary's Abbey in the United Kingdom about 30 years ago. May she rest in God's eternal peace. All of the above, always remembered through these years in praying at the altar. Lord, teach us to pray. Jesus said, when you pray, say, Our Father. His response is the answer for humanity's desire for healing, wholeness, reconciliation, and peace, physically, emotionally, and most importantly, spiritually. This is known most supremely in the first words of Jesus' response, Our Father. That is, his Father is our Father and ever near to us. Healing in and from God is anything but transactional. It arises from an encounter, a relationship with Jesus Christ, crucified and risen. There is a recurring pattern in the Gospels. Jesus heals, retreats, in this case for an entire night to pray to the Father, and then to return and meet multitudes who want to be near him, touch him, connect to his power, and be cured of many maladies. Their needs were great. as are the needs of the human family in every age. Jesus' purpose is singular: to proclaim, make manifest the loving and compassionate power of God and the inbreaking of God's kingdom. Every time Jesus cured, healed, made whole, and restored those who sought him, it was to this end. The healing that God offers the world is recorded throughout the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, intensely and compellingly in Jesus Christ, in the apostles, and then rolling on through the ages into this day. Through 45 years of ministry, I have witnessed the arcing reach of Jesus' compassion and healing power in many lives and my own. Perhaps you have known this in your life and in others across the years. Perhaps you long for it now, yourself, and for those close to you in this beautiful yet broken and wounded world. Christ's healing love is always, always just a prayer, a cry, a plea away, ever near and present. Simply turn to him, call upon him, and he will come to you. And do not think you need to have a rich faith or have your life all buttoned down. If you are afraid or in some darkness, God knows this. Christ is there. Turn to him. You may have little faith or a shaky, wobbly faith, but if it's in the Lord Jesus Christ, you don't have to have faith enough to hold on to him. He'll hold you. At 19 years old and home for Christmas break, I stopped on my way to work at a large hospital where my father had been admitted the night before. He had cancer for several years with an unexpected and long remission. That was now over. Entering his room that cold morning, I knew immediately that something was very wrong. Within a moment, the medical crash carts and the personnel began rushing into his room. And I withdrew from the room and down a corridor and stared for long moments out a window across the city, afraid, confused, sad. And I knew it was the end. At one point, I felt a hand rest upon my shoulder. I never turned around. I think it was a nurse. And after all these years, I still remember that moment as the hand of Christ reaching to me. Perhaps you have known this or offered the same in some way. You know, for some, you may be the only Jesus they ever encounter. As Gerard Manley Hopkins wrote, "Christ plays in 10,000 places, lovely in limbs, lovely in eyes, not his." Very soon, we will enter the dramatic sweep of the power and power of Holy Week, observed no more beautifully anywhere in the world as it is here. Around the world, Christians will join in prayer and worship most profoundly in those three sacred days, climaxing at Easter Vigil and Day. In that prayer of the church, our prayers, our lives are joined to the crucified and risen Christ, who brings to the world ultimate healing and reconciliation, here, everywhere, just as it was in 2005 and 6 in Baghdad, Iraq, where I served as an army chaplain in a humble plywood battalion chapel, a makeshift Paschal candle illuminated the cool dark night for an Easter vigil of unbridled joy. Seven brothers in Christ in the profession of arms raised the first alleluias of Easter in a land of ancient faith, deepest history, and in need of healing from war, injury, and the killing of too many innocents. There, in the midst of a Good Friday world, we met Christ's healing in our prayers, the prayers of the church, and Christ held us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Crucified, draw you to himself that you may find in him a sure ground for faith, a firm support for hope, and the assurance of sins forgiven, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.